In this short video, I would like to explain how to do a Fourier transform, Fourier analysis, Fourier decomposition, FFT, fast Fourier transform, discrete Fourier transform, however you would like to call it in MATLAB. A student asked me this question, sent me some data. So here's the data. Let's have a look at the data. As you can see, the data is some simulation in COMSOL, and we have some timestamps, time values. On first glance, I would say they are equally spaced in equal time step distances, and for each time step we have some electromagnetic force component in the unit Newton. And as you can see, we have lots of these time steps, around 500 of these time steps, and now we need to get this data into MATLAB. So the easiest way to load this data into MATLAB and the safest way is to delete this header so that we just have the data and save it as a new file, call it that. Then I can close it again, and then we can load this data, and I will put it into a variable that is called raw data, and load this data, that file, the one without the header. And I will escape the output with the semicolon, and now you can see we have 501 times 2 values. And so we can load the time and say this is from this raw data vector. These are all rows in the first column. So now we have 501 times, and we can also get this force. I will call it F from X. It's the second column of this raw data matrix. Okay, so now we have time and time steps and time values. Now we want to do the Fourier analysis. And there's a function for this, which is called FFT. So this does this discrete Fourier transform, but to be honest, this FFT function is not very nice for engineers. It's nice for mathematicians, but for engineers, it's quite difficult to understand because you just give the values as a function of the time, and then you get back the spectrum. But you have to take care about the amplitude of the spectrum, and about for which frequencies now you calculate the spectrum, you have to take care yourself. And therefore, a colleague of mine, and I will open it up here, a colleague of mine, unfortunately, the comments are all in German, but maybe I will translate it if I offer this file for download. So a colleague of mine, Dr. Kotschetow in Magdeburg, developed this, and I reworked it a little bit also a couple of years ago. And so now, what is the advantage of this Fourier function? This Fourier function takes time steps and takes the corresponding time values, and then you get back not only the spectrum, you also get back the frequencies for which these spectral components belong to. And then you can set a mode. And the mode is, is it a single pulse that you are looking at, or is it continuous, like sine waveform, something like this? So we will try to find out which type of file do we have here, or which type of data we have here. So I will shortly plot the time and this F from X, just to have some idea how this looks like. And as usual, MATLAB takes some time for plotting. And then I would say it looks like a continuous function. Yeah, it looks like it does not look like a single pulse. It looks like it would repeat after one. So it looks like this is, let's say, one period of time, and after this period of time. Anyhow, even if this is not a period of time, the FFT will anyhow assume that this time function does periodically repeat. So we need to use, we should use this sinus mode. And so now we can calculate the spectrum very easily, and say we will get the frequencies. We will get, I will call this FX now as a function of the frequency. And we insert our t and fx. I should have called this fx from t, but it's just fx. And the mode is sinus. And again, with the semicolon, I will escape the output. And now you can see we got back 251 frequencies and corresponding to these 251 frequencies, we also got back 251 spectral components, spectral density. Now it's not really density, now they are scaled in a way that they really have the unit Newton. I think this is also somewhere given here in the comments of this function. And so what we can do now, of course, is we can plot the spectrum and take a look at the spectrum. So these are the frequencies, these are the spectral components. And now what will happen, I think, is that MATLAB will raise some error message that it's just plotting the real parts and ignoring the imaginary parts. And I have to look for the plot window. It's given here. Of course, this spectrum is complex valued. And maybe one question is why we have inserted 501 values. Why do we get back only 251, approximately half of them? Yeah, because the FFT function calculates positive and negative frequencies. And in an engineering sense, only positive frequencies make sense. From the engineering point of view, because the negative frequencies are just the complex conjugate of the positive frequencies. If we have a real value time function, and in engineering, in the field of engineering, we usually only have real valued time functions. So these positive and negative frequencies just make sense if you have also really complex value time functions. But in the time domain, in the field of engineering, more or less all time functions are real valued. So we can ignore this negative frequencies. Okay, so what might be better than this is, of course, if we plot the absolute value, just the magnitude, and again, have a look at the plot. And then it looks like this. So we just have, as we could imagine from this time function, just very low frequency components in there. I can try to zoom in, or I can adjust the x limit a little bit and say we should start from the frequency of 0 and then maybe go to 20 hertz, something like this. Oops. And I think I've closed the plot before. So this now should work better. Yeah, and then we can see, okay, if I add a data tip, data cursor. So then we can see we have a peak at 1.1 hertz and we have a second peak at around 5 hertz, which is inside some other frequencies. Now one might say, okay, why do we get this continuous plot? Does this really make sense? Because we are not really calculating a continuous spectrum. We just have a spectral component here and there and there, and everything in between these lines, it's just linear interpolation. It's just a lucky guess. And there is nothing really in between. So one better plot to do this would be a stem plot. And let's have a look how a stem plot looks like. There we just really have only these single lines. And again, if I adjust the x limit a little bit, then again we can see, okay, we have this large component here at the low frequencies, very very low, around 1 hertz, and then this 5 hertz component here a bit higher frequency. But of course, in terms of electric engineering, 5 hertz is also super super low frequency. So this is here, of course, one should add axis labels. This is the frequency in hertz, and this is now the amplitude of the oscillation in Newton. So just for completeness, I will add this x label as the frequency in hertz, and the y label is now our force amplitude in Newton. Okay, so then the plot makes more sense, and it's the amplitude. It's just the magnitude of these oscillations. So we have an oscillation at this frequency, and so on. And now that's it, more or less. One might also be interested in plotting not only the amplitude spectrum but also the phase of these components. So how do we get the phase? This is a complex value. This is the complex spectrum. And if we want to have the phase, we don't use ABS, we use angle. So I will add a second figure. There's a second figure, and then we can inside the second figure plot the angle of this complex value, which is like the phase angle of this complex value, and this will be in radians. I want to have it in degrees, so I multiply with 180 divide by p, then I get the phase angle in degree, and plot it once again, and the x-axis is again frequency, and the y-axis is now the phase of each component in degree. And then the plot, the second plot, should look like this. And then, this looks quite usual that the phases inside the spectrum, they are typically somehow uncorrelated. Again, we now get it for all frequencies, so it looks kind of weird. The interesting phases are probably, again, the ones when I limit the x-axis, the frequency axis, to the low frequencies. And we had some important component here at around 1 hertz. So this has some minus 130 degree phase shift. This has about 0 degree phase shift. And I think then the 5 hertz component, maybe I can open up the other plot here. And in both plots, again, a grid would be very, very helpful. Maybe I can say grid on, and then at least I have now a grid here, and I can also enable the grid in the second plot, and then I also have a grid in the second plot. And now we can see, okay, no, it was this 4 hertz component here. This was no, it was here the 5 hertz component. This was quite strong, this one here, so this has around 60 degree phase shift, I would assume. And so this is the way if I go back to load data into MATLAB, separated in times and in the corresponding time values of our function that we want to analyze, then we use this Fourier function. It takes the time, takes this time values, takes a mode, now sine, because it's the continuous function. We get back frequencies and the spectral components, and then we just plot these spectral components. And as you can imagine, there is a second function called inf-Fourier, and this does the same in the opposite direction. It's some inverse Fourier transform. So this one, again, the comments are unfortunately in German. This one takes frequency and spectral components, again takes this mode, and then gives you back the time steps, time values, and the corresponding values of your time function. That's it.